Good morning and welcome to all to the first virtual forum of our 2020 Domestic Financial Institutions Conference. COVID-19 intervened and forced a postponement of our plans for our traditional DFIC back in April. It is now time for us to resume our public outreach. Towards the end of last month, we launched a remodeled Caribbean Economic Forum. And earlier this month, we hosted a webinar on central bank digital currencies. Launching this virtual forum today is a recognition that despite the temporary lockdown and the need for physical distancing, business in the financial sector must move forward. The pandemic has reminded us of the vulnerability of regional economies. Given that international supply chains may be subject to periodic disruption, it also reminds us of the need to strengthen food and energy security in order for us to enhance the economic viability of this region. Moreover, it has impressed upon everyone the need to be flexible and to demonstrate resilience when faced with challenges. In my brief remarks this morning, I will focus on how the financial sector has adjusted to the altered environment created by COVID-19, and how, as a country, we can prepare ourselves from a macroeconomic perspective to cope with the economic obstacles that we are likely to face. The financial sector has been at the forefront of adaptation in recent months. First, business closures and lost incomes have induced lending institutions to provide broad-based moratoria on loan payments to their customers, corporates, and individuals alike, to enable them to grapple with the economic and financial challenges caused by COVID-19. For some, this may be construed as a human face to banking. It creates an opportunity for renewed interaction between borrowers and creditors in search of mutually acceptable means of extending the social safety net beyond initiatives implemented by government to minimize the impact of lost livelihoods. Safeguarding the financial welfare of individuals and businesses and ensuring that the private sector has access to working capital remains crucial for accelerating a vigorous economic recovery. Secondly, the central bank has adapted regulatory policy to enable these lending institutions to manage the disruption caused by this crisis and to make available, if necessary, low-cost liquidity support. Yet, none of our licensees has had to avail themselves of this facility. A reflection at the size of the pre-COVID-19 capital and liquidity buffers has been adequate to cope with the initial shock. The bank remains committed to work with its licensees during this challenging period to ensure that financial stability is not impaired. Thirdly, we have witnessed a fascinating response from the private sector, evidenced by increased domestic e-commerce and greater use of e-banking and digital payments. Reduced in-person transactions and interactions over these past few months have boosted our efforts to reduce the use of paper-based payment instruments such as cash and checks. We have had a glimpse into the future of how business and payments will be conducted. And preliminary data for the April to June quarter indicates a substantial reduction in check usage and increased use of electronic transfers via the automated clearinghouse, or ACH. This transition provides a platform for customers in search of low-cost banking services to alter their banking practices in response to the fees charged by some institutions. As you know, the bank is keen to encourage further financial inclusion. And as a means of promoting increased transparency, it has committed to publishing select fees of commercial banks on its website. I can announce that the first publication of these fees will be available today. While the list does not include the full range of fees, the bank has captured some of the most common ones that institutions charge on traditional products so that persons in the market for personal retail banking services can compare what various entities are imposing when making their banking decisions. In addition to updating these fees periodically, the bank may expand the select range of fees over time. However, each bank remains obligated to publish their fee structure on their individual website and to give adequate notice before the changes. Over the course of the next few weeks, as we explore how the sector is adapting to the changes in the environment, We will examine in our virtual forum themes that touch directly or indirectly on the implications of COVID-19, including the emerging payments landscape, AML practices and policy, financial stability, and the psychosocial impacts of COVID-19 itself. This morning, however, our discussion centers on another issue that accentuates our vulnerability and creates the need for constant adaptation, that is climate change. We are having this discussion about this phenomenon during the hurricane season, one that again promises to be more active than usual. The timing is indeed fitting, therefore, because this is perhaps the time of year when we are most reminded of the effects of climate change and the havoc it can wreak on our peoples and our economies. We need only to look at the impact on our regional brothers and sisters whose lives were turned upside down as a result of Hurricanes Dorian, Irma, and Maria, among others, or consider the cost of the damage and the losses sustained to understand the magnitude of the environmental, societal, and economic consequences of climate change. In Barbados, we have been spared the fury of recent storms, but we have felt the impact of the external shocks caused by climate change. Droughts and floods give rise to increased commodity prices, and our panelists and farmers can tell a dismal story of the impact of drought on our agricultural sector. Climate change also has the potential to threaten our tourism sector. Beach erosion and sargassum seaweed can spoil our lovely beaches and put our number one foreign exchange earner at risk. COVID-19 has shown us just how economically devastating a steep decline in tourism can be. In our Sir Winston Scott Memorial Lecture last year, Jesus Gaspar Martin argued that while small island states did not cause climate change, and while they can't fix it on their own, there are measures that can be taken to mitigate it. At the domestic level, building codes and the quality of physical structures, insurance and access to resilience financing are but some of the measures that will serve as mitigants. But I believe that there's a role also for macroeconomic policy in adaptation to climate change. Too often, the destructive forces of climate change create large financing gaps that require financial assistance from abroad. This creates the potential for delays in starting the process of repair and rebuilding. It is for this reason that the government of Barbados, as part of its domestic and external debt restructurings, negotiated for the inclusion of a provision that allows government to defer payments for 2 years in the event that a natural disaster strikes. This moratorium on payments would afford us breathing room to enable us to get our economy back on track. However, we cannot rely on deferred payments alone. It is critical that we continue to strengthen our overall macroeconomic framework and to build buffers that allow us to react quickly to shocks, such as climate change or pandemics. The past 2 years has focused on this endeavor, the results of which enabled us to face this pandemic with strengthened public finances, reduced indebtedness, and a buildup of international reserves. Critically, the confidence in our progress that these developments have inspired has catalyzed Barbados' access to further financial resources from international agencies. Our international reserves passed $2.1 billion last week, an unprecedented level, up from just $440 million 2 years ago. This stock represents over 28 weeks of import reserve cover that will be further buttressed in the coming months through additional budgetary support from international lending agencies. We have transitioned from selling foreign exchange to banks at a time of high debt service to purchasing foreign exchange, even during a period of diminished earnings. It speaks both to increased confidence and to greater diversification of earnings than might have otherwise been thought. This buffer reserves will allow us to absorb any shocks associated with rising commodity prices or a general pickup in demand in the coming months without concerns of pressure on the exchange rate. At the same time, COVID-19 has reduced economic activity, business closures, and increased unemployment has weakened revenue from domestic sources. However, This has been partially offset by rising corporation taxes from the international business sector. In recent weeks, government has been able to build up deposits with the central bank rather than borrowing, as is its normal custom. As you might expect, this situation will eventually reverse, but it is the accumulation of buffers that will facilitate plan growth enhancing expenditure. Indeed, given the lower revenues expected, we have relaxed our fiscal target for this year, securing the knowledge that additional budgetary support from the IFIs will further enhance our financing buffers while permitting government to increase its focus on capital spending now that economic activity has been reduced. As revenues recover fully, government will revert to larger primary balances needed to ensure that fiscal policy remains sustainable and that new debt issuance is managed in a structured manner. It is the combined effect of the reserve accumulation, access to new funding, and continued fiscal discipline that will enable government to continue to honor all its commitments. These positive macroeconomic developments serve as the backdrop to our discussion today and for this series of seminars. I'm sure that our panel will offer the perspectives of both technical experts and those who can give an economic and financial sector viewpoint. I trust, therefore, that this will be an informative and productive session, and that you will leave eagerly anticipating the next session in the series and committed to adopting policies, promoting practices, and lending your voice to efforts to address climate change issues and their impact on our society, environments, and the economy. We owe it to generations to come. I thank you.
Thank you, Governor. We sincerely appreciate your opening remarks. We have compiled together an astute of panelists to our topic today, mitigating the effects of climate change or financial sector perspective. I will first introduce you to all four of our team, and as they do the individual presentations, I will then give you some more detail. We have Tia Browne, and she's a meteorologist from the Barbados Geology Service, who's one of our panelists, together with Charles Yearwood, who will give us a technical perspective. We also have Senator Crystal Drakes, who is also an economist and changes. And then we have Mr. Randy Graham, who's an insurance sector specialist. Let me first introduce Tia to you, who will give the scientific background with respect to climate change. Now, Tia Browne has been a meteorologist in this meteorology service for the past 5 years. Her main duties involve weather forecasting, both for Barbados. Over the past 5 years, involving several training workshops. Tia also says it includes geographical information systems. She's also worked with climate modeling systems, as well as the Caribbean Regional Climate Outlook Forum. From this training, she says, she's generated seasonal national climate outlooks for Barbados, and she also led the development of the Barbados National Climate Outlook newsletter provided by the Barbados Meteorological Service. Her interest continues to be diverse, both in the fields of climatology as well as meteorology. She's a strong believer in staying true to yourself. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Ms. Tia Browne to give us the scientific background when it comes to climate change as it relates to Barbados and the Caribbean. Tia?
Then we will end with some vulnerability to climate change based on the specific sectors. Now, there are many factors that drive the climate of Barbados, but in particular, I will deal with the El Nino Southern Oscillation, which is also known as This is an interaction between the ocean and the atmosphere in the equatorial Pacific, which results in periodic departures from the expected sea surface temperatures, or what is usually expected. Now, there are two phases of ENSO, which we are familiar with: El Nino, which is the warm phase, and La Nina, which is the cool phase. Now, not only does this affect the climate in the Pacific, but it also has impacts in the Atlantic, in the Caribbean, and in the Gulf of Mexico as well. Now, in general, during El Nino events, we typically see more tropical storms and hurricanes in the eastern Pacific, while we see a decrease in the Atlantic, the Gulf of Mexico, and the Caribbean Sea. During El Nino years, it's not to say that we wouldn't get storms or hurricanes, but it simply means that the conditions are less favorable for tropical cyclone development. Contrast is true for La Nina, during which we normally see more favorable conditions for tropical cyclone development. But looking beyond just tropical cyclones, we can also see a trend in our rainfall based on the episodes of ENSO. So in the top, we're going to take a look at the rainfall patterns over the past decade from 2010 to 2019, and we're going to use the Met Office station at Pernox as the example. Now, you can see starting from 2010 during the La Nina event, you can see we had an increase in our rainfall during 2010. But if we go from 2010 into 2013, you start to see a decrease in trend as we come out of La Nina phase and heading into neutral phase, which, by the way, is the normal conditions or what is normally expected. If we see from 2014 into 2015 during El Nino conditions, you can see there is a significant decline in the island's rainfall during those years. Likewise, during La Nina, as we head into 2016, 2017, and 2018, we can see that we had an increase in rainfall as well. But as we transition to neutral conditions, we can see again by 2019, we would have experienced a significant decrease in the island's rainfall. So mainly during La Nina conditions, we tend to see above average rainfall experience for the island. And during El Nino conditions, we tend to see a decrease in our rainfall over the past years. 2010 is actually is the highest year on record. We had over 1800 millimeters. 2015 is the third lowest year on record for yearly rainfall. And 2019, as we know, we were experiencing drought. That is the lowest on record, not just from 2010, but as we look back into the past, actually the lowest on record since 1942. Now, what we're looking at here is the yearly rainfall starting from when records began in 1942 right up to 2019. See from here that most of the years are actually below average from 1942. And we have, if we look at the red line, it's actually suggesting between 1978 and 1980, we saw a slight increasing trend in rainfall as we head into 2019. Just looking at our rainfall, we're also going to take a look at tropical cyclone activity over the past years. Now, 2017 was a more memorable year for us as we had three major storms in the Atlantic at one time, those being Maria most significantly, which would have devastated Dominica. But last year, we would have also had tropical storm Dorian, which would have affected Barbados at that time. Fortunately for us, it was not a hurricane as it passed over the island and the Eastern Caribbean, but as we know, it went on to become a major hurricane and wreak havoc over the Bahamas. But we did have some close calls over the past few years. So we're gonna zoom in now on 2019. Reason being, this was the year when we had lowest rainfall on record. And despite March and April being above average, the red, we're looking at 2019 observed rainfall, and in the blue in the background, we're looking at the climatological rainfall. We can see for March and April, we would have experienced above normal rainfall, but throughout the rest of the year, we would have been experiencing below normal rainfall to the island, not just for across the Caribbean, but across Barbados as well last year, and heading into the early stages of 2020. We were still experiencing moderately dry conditions, and this has had a significant impact on our groundwater resources, which would have led to water restrictions, and also it was a concern for water quality and reduced crop yields. So let's take a look at the current state of the climate. So we're going to be looking at the 2020 rainfall trend for Charnocks using the Met Office station as the example again. The darker blue, we're going to be looking at the total observed monthly rainfall, and the lighter blue will be the climatological conditions. Now, again, we see an above average rainfall experience in February, but for January, March, April, and May, most significantly, we're still experiencing below average rainfall. So even though coming out of 2019, we were still in a drought, we are still continuing to see below average rainfall experience, at least for the first 6 months of 2020. We're just going to take a quick look at the rainfall distribution from some stations across the island. January, some stations would have experienced above normal rainfall, but as we head into March, April, and May, we can see that those stations would have also been experiencing below average rainfall. And by June, at least for the Met Office station in Charnocks and some stations in St. Philip, now starting to see near normal rainfall as the hurricane season or the wet season began in June. So take a quick look at the temperatures. Maximum and minimum temperatures and the mean temperature for Charnocks and the Met Office station. The blue will be the observed conditions and the orange will be the climatological conditions. And we can see there's slightly above average temperatures were being observed at least up until the end of May. It's also important to mention that we would have encountered several heatwave days during the summer of 2019. So going back to the whole idea of ENSO and El Nino and La Nina, this is the sea surface temperature anomaly data up to the 1st of July 2020. And we can see if we look in the East Pacific, you can see the blue, which is signifying below average sea surface temperatures, which is indicative of La Nina conditions developing. So what does this mean for us? So from the graph that we just saw before, is suggesting La Nina conditions expected at least up until July. But if we also take a look at the outlook for the rest of the year and into early 2021, and so neutral conditions are expected to continue throughout summer, and there is a 50 to 55% chance of La Nina conditions developing through fall and continuing through the winter of 2020-2021. So as we've seen, we normally experience increase in rainfall during La Nina conditions. So the outlook is suggesting that there may be some relief as we head into the remainder of the year. Look at the rainfall probability forecast. The greener areas will be above normal rainfall and the browner areas will be indicating below normal rainfall. So on the left, we'll be looking at the rainfall outlook for July to September, which is suggesting near normal or above normal rainfall, especially in areas of St. Philip and the northern parishes. If we look at the long-term forecast on the right from October to November, as we head in from October to December, we can see that there's an increasing trend in above normal rainfall expected towards the end of the year. So there is the possibility that we can be coming out of the drought conditions. So we'll take a look at the 6 month and 12 month drought outlooks. Now, expecting some relief of the drought conditions towards the end of the year, there are some areas which are still of a concern, more so if we look at the groundwater reservoirs. St. John in particular, which would have been severely impacted by the drought conditions, there's still some dry conditions which will be expected at the end of September and November. So we know this is going to be a very active hurricane season with 19 names, 9 hurricanes, and 4 Category 3 or higher. But we've already been there, which formed last Friday, just off the US East Coast. And the next one form will be Gonzalo. What does this mean for the sectors across Barbados? We'll take a look at the agricultural and environmental sectors. Complete rain-fed crops due to longer dry periods and shorter rainy seasons, as well as increased temperatures, is something that we have to pay attention to, as well as increases in pathogen vectors due to the availability of water. We have been experiencing Saharan dust outbreaks recently, and more frequent Saharan dust outbreaks in the dry season and the early part of the hurricane season will impact heavily on the respiratory health of Barbados. With respect to the tourism sector, increased tropical cyclone activity has a significant impact on our ports of entry. And also, if we take a look at the underground water supply to the national needs and increasing demand will be significantly under threat over the next few years if this dry trend was to continue. I've been experiencing drought, and the likelihood of drought occurring in the future is also something that we need to take into consideration. So there needs to be supplemental alternatives to the current system to meet the demands of all sectors and the sustainability of life. So in concluding, Barbados, along with the Caribbean, we are highly vulnerable to climate change. Over the years, we've experienced significant drought, more recently 19. And being located in the Caribbean, we are highly exposed to tropical cyclone activity. We've been fortunate to not have experienced any major hurricanes or Category 5 hurricanes over the years. But also, we have to take into consideration warmer temperatures. Last year, we would have experienced a lot of warm days, and that's something that we have to consider as we move forward into the future. Also, our resources are very limited. We depend heavily on our underground coral aquifers, and we are tourism dependent. So we need to have some mitigation methods in place as the climate changes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tia. Tia, you've clearly demonstrated that whilst we are confronting the current COVID-19 crisis, we must still keep our eyes focused vision on the looming crisis that seems to be on the horizon, a climatic crisis. You has quite aptly pointed out, we have had unusual amounts of the Sahara dust, and we've had drought conditions for a number of years. So you've set the technical boundary quite well for us that we must pay attention to it. We have one of the panelists now who will also give us another technical perspective, and this is from the infrastructure point of view. And his name is Mr. Charles Yearwood. Now, Charles is a senior technical officer responsible for drainage division of the Ministry of Transport, Works and Maintenance. He says, as a child, his schooling in Bruce Vale Valley, scouting and observing his grandmother's farming helped him foster his desire to look after the environment. He said this led him to a Bachelor of Science degree in Physical Planning and Environmental Resource Development from the University of Technology, Jamaica. He's also the holder of a certificate in River and Dam Engineering from Japan Public Works Research Institute and a holder of a Master's in Project Management and Evaluation from the University of the West Indies. His research interests include stormwater management, flood mitigation, and physical environmental issues. And he's written and presented several papers on these areas at workshops, seminars, and conferences in Latin America, the USA, Europe, and Asia. Let's welcome Charles Yearwood, who will give us another technical perspective on the impact of climate change can have on our environment and infrastructure. Charles?
I'm very much aware of and know. Are you seeing the background? Are you seeing the PowerPoint presentation?
Yes, we are, Charles.
Okay, right. I said thank you again for allowing me to present the paper on flood mitigation. But while you asked to look at the hurricanes, I thought we should look at mitigation measures on disaster flood risk. It is a topic in which very few people we live, and everyone who experienced intense flooding events would have some experience, but don't always understand the science and the work behind by the government and private sector to mitigate flooding. In this presentation, I have developed 8 points which to develop. I've seen the contents. The background is that hurricanes generate, as we heard just now, climate change. But in terms of the impact of, in fact, normally for climate change, you have hurricanes and storms. And these events cause loss of life and damage to property. They are the hydrometeorological events, not only hurricanes, but tropical depressions and storms, which produce severe flooding. And these in total cause more economic damages than those in total of hurricanes. And we have more small events than hurricanes sometimes, but the summation of all the losses accrued from the smaller tropical depressions and storms generate more losses. We also have flood event records, which provide the impact of hurricanes and storms on Barbados. Over the past century, there have been significant losses of flood-producing events, on average about 10 to 12 years return. And you see a list of major events, and these were taken from records research, but most of them are in excess of 100 millimeters in their total rainfall. The losses, although you're looking from 1901 to present, remember or concern yourself with that the landscape was not always the way it is. The rate of development has not been. And therefore, the method records there, but the losses may not be less in the same rainfall event than you have today, in that Bridgetown was not as developed. You didn't have as many residential developments, and you had more sustainable agricultural practices. What are the contributors to flooding? Many contributors to flooding deal with land, changing land use patterns and urban infilling with development in natural waterways. We all know where we go along as children, you do the vernal houses because flood water is passing those areas. And now you pass them, you'll see some structure, whether it's for habitable or to support habitable activity. We have particularly on this in the Scotland district and on the west coast, steep gullies, the steep elevations in short runs and therefore steep gullies. We also had mechanization agriculture, which have led to compaction of soils and lands and greater runoff. We're confronted with, as they identified just now, climate change predictions. And with that, with those predictions, we're talking about the frequency of intense storms. And let me stop here, since we deal with climate change, to expand on this one. When we talk about intense storms, drought also have an impact, or the impact of climate change and drought have an impact on flood mitigation. How is that? When there are the absence of rain and drought, and there's drought, you have dry soils, grasses that cover the lands, dry up and expose soils. You have natural breakdown of the trees, branches and limbs and leaves and light. And in the first flush of rains, that is a heavy debris load that could otherwise block drains and culverts and find its way into the sea. We have the lack of coordinated watershed management approach to flood prevention, in that there's this piecemeal approach where within a watershed, you have many landowners and landowners with different interests, and it's oftentimes the interest conflict. We have beach sand berms, where due to the advent of the sewage projects in Bridgetown and the South Coast, we see an increased quality of seawater. And concomitant with that, you have increased accretion of sand. And what is the positive for or resource in a beach development and activities associated with it? These sand berms also block outfalls so that water back up and cannot get out to the sea and otherwise flood low-lying areas. You also talk about the ineffective drainage structures and disposal methods. Our city and many of our settlements in excess of a century old. They were developed at the time when we didn't have the increased rainfall we run off today or increased intensity of storms. And therefore, we needed some time to change out these structures to larger structures that can take the flood flows from modern day. There's also flood damages that are higher than flood mitigation budget, so that the volume of damage to mitigate is much more than our budgets. And we then have to go significant sums over above our annual allocations or find some method of funding to provide to finance these drainage structures. And of course, there's negative cultural practices in the context of garbage disposal. So what are the potential effects of climate change on flooding? I've identified 8 items here, and they all contribute in some way to unflooding and impacts on flooding. Higher air temperatures, higher sea temperatures, sea level rise. The first two gives rise when you have higher sea temperatures and air temperatures, you have relations of drought or increased storms. And in some cases, you have storm surge, the sea level rise. And on top of that, sea level rise. So once this, you have storm surges, the water, the elevation of the sea is higher than the land at times or backs up into the outfalls. And then you have, when you have storms, the water's on top of that, and then it abates or it retains the storm, the flood, the waters are flush onto the lands for a longer period of time, hence you have increased flooding periods. You all have the amount of intensity of storms for rainfall, so you have greater rainfall amounts over normal, you have greater intensities of rainfall, so that you have more rain in a shorter time, and then you have some of the times more tropical events, storms and short rainfall events. The Drainage Division responsible for prevention of flooding has adopted a model of flood management, of integrated flood management. This is a subset of integrated water resources management that deals specifically with flood management. It is at the intersect of water resources management, coastal zone management, and hazard management. And at the center of it is land use planning, development, and management. The objectives of integrated flood management is to have river basin or watershed basin approach, see floods as beneficial, maximize the floodplains, minimize loss of life, and that floods can never be fully controlled. You may design for a storm of 1 or 25 year return or 1 or 50 year return. But then you have the great floods, as they would be sometime, and they're very rare. Sometimes in people's lives, there's only one rare storm in your life, maybe 100-year storm. Then you have excess runoff, and those runoffs cannot easily pass through the existing structures. What is mitigation? FEMA defines mitigation as the effort to reduce loss of life and property by lessening the impact of disasters. The last definition I like that best is, it says it's a process of determining how to reduce or eliminate the loss of life and property damage resulting from natural and human-caused hazards. Oftentimes, people associate flooding with natural. There's also human intervention can also exacerbate or intensify the effect of flooding. There's a legal framework for flooding. I've identified most of them. You have the Flood Prevention Act, the Highways Act, and the purpose of those acts are next to them. You have the Town Planning Act, Development Act, the Coastal Zone Management Act, the Emergency Management Act, and then we have Building Permit Guidelines for Rainwater Harvesting and Reuse under the Environmental Protection Division. So I'll move straight into mitigation measures adopted and used by the Drainage Division Barbados. I've identified and are having in two different classes. We have structural measures and we have non-structural measures. Those structural measures are things you can see visibly, things that are on the surface of the land which you can see. And then I'll come later to the non-structural measures. In terms of the structural measures, I've identified the existing measures and then future considerations or those that we are considering at this time. There are three then classes within the structural measures. The first is runoff, retardation, and control. In this way, we attempt to collect and dispose of the runoff or storm water in a safe manner and away from human settlement and to reduce loss of property, whether it be cars on the road or items or property possessions lost in the home or outside the home. There are check dams, the drainage reserves and retarding basins. Earlier settlements used suck wells and check dams, but and they still have the use utility and they have great utility to us. However, we found through research, and I found through research, that these are not the only measures that can be relied on today, since we have increased runoff. Therefore, we need to have what we consider low impact developments of green infrastructure, which are at a lot level or at close to source. So we're not relying anymore on the water, the rain to fall, and then to run on the surface for over 300 a kilometer distance on land. We want to collect that water as close as possible to where it's falling, so that you reduce the amount of water, the runoff on the road. We can also use retarding basins. They're akin to what we call depressions or sinkholes or cossies across the landscape of our island. As you drive, you will see ponds in fields. Then those depressions do capture and hold and retard, and some in most cases infiltrate in the soil to reduce runoff on the road and to close to habitable structures. And the other one, move on to is river improvement or watercourse improvement. The waterways are defined through the natural processes. Over time, human activity have even narrowed them or built within the watercourse spaces. In this way, we want to do river training, and predominantly the Scotland district, where we are able to retrain, because of the Scotland district is not rock, the geology is clay, and they move, the river meanders over time, depends on the storm or the flow, and we retrain the river with heavy equipment. We also have revetments and bridge culverts and replacements. Remember I mentioned earlier that sometimes over time and increased development activity, there's a need to change the culverts and bridges to have a greater capacity of flow runoff under them. And then we move to watercourse environment. This is not only in the river basin or the channel itself, but the lands next to the watercourse. We know that there's debris, indiscriminate dumping of garbage, and oftentimes it finds its way into the gully, from the gully side into the waterway, and we have to do debris cleaning occasionally. And there are many, we want at this time thank many of the volunteer groups who over time do gully cleanups. And then we go to watercourse clearing, not to clear all the vegetation, but to clear the debris, not only debris, but sometimes shrubs that may impede the flow of the water. And then we have new spur dikes where occasionally we use structures to reduce the flow or to cushion the impact on culverts downstream. In the future considerations, we believe that low part developments, harvesting, holding water at sites, creating gardens, and the avoidance of hard cover area in your lands can lead to reduce flooding, and we advocate those. And because of river improvement, we go towards aquatic life improvement. The rivers are living organisms, and we need oftentimes to use them to the benefit for science, for research, for even to increase the oxygen content with our environment. And in watercourse environment, we think of wandos and vegetation restoration, a local vegetation and plants. We move now to non-structural support systems or non-structural measures, what are considered to be support systems. They are 1 to 5 areas of identified data collection, I should say, data collection and research, education awareness, floodplain management, emergency activities, and institutional. On the existing systems, we do have a small hydro data collection network where we collect rainfall and level of flood. So we have a relationship between rainfall and flood in a given area. And we usually research to get that data collection in areas we know to flood or areas we have a prediction for flooding. In terms of educational awareness, we have community meetings with the DEOs, district emergency organizations, other interest groups, the Lions, PTAs call and ask for presentations, and we do facilitate those. And then there are specialized tours in flood-prone areas for students at the O level or the CAPE level. And we also, we've got two students at this time with master's level in water resources management, who we assist and facilitate through our work here. So that we get the scientific community to be part of the research and hope that some of these persons through time will use the opportunity to probably look towards a career in stormwater management. In case of in some item of floodplain management, this is where I spend much time here, because this is where we have lands that have the potential for flooding and for which people have ownership or have rights in the land, and often they believe that they can then develop the land to them to maximize their incomes. But we have to also remember that people should also be aware that we have to live with nature, and we must respect water because of the forces that it has with it and the impact it can have on human life and property. So we're talking about landfill controls or garbage sites controls. We also require a 1 to 25 years minimum drainage plan for developments, particular subdivisions. We carry out drainage impact assessments on development applications. We conduct through assistance of private foreign, oftentimes consultancies, floodplain maps in localized areas. And then we, of course, development control. We ensure that persons who have development permission, physical development permission, are doing what they have permission to do and not beyond that. In the context of emergency activities, we recognize that there will be flooding, and we oftentimes are not able to carry out, we don't have all the money and resources to carry out all the flood mitigation in every area of flood. And therefore, we recognize that we need to do flood fighting. We also do conduct flood observations so that we are aware of the behavior of the flood through time. And then we have what's considered to be disaster prevention stations, where we have work depots who operate during the intense storms, particularly hurricanes, as part of a system to respond to flooding within the districts. And then there's institutional, where we have flood prevention legislation I mentioned earlier, some above. We have flood disaster prevention division in the drainage division with a budget on, from government. And then we have, under the disaster emergency management framework, a technical coastal hazards committee, whose responsibility is look not only at hazards, but coastal hazards, not only in terms of flooding, but also we look at storm surge and others. For future work, under data collection, we believe we should have, we'd like to have a wider hydrometric network, because there are many more sites being developed and there's a potential for flooding. There's the use of CCTV cameras, and we hope to access some of the footage to monitor flooding during time. And of course, during COVID, we see how the use of cell phone and websites are being used without human interaction. And we, while we use some of it now, we think we can use greater utility of these technologies for flood management. In the context of educational awareness, there's a need for greater flood crisis management seminars. There are very few, in fact, in my time, there's only been two seminars on flood, and it's been flooding in the context and water resources management. We think we need to establish a river museum, whether in-house or with, in association with the museum society. People need to understand the history of places and what's happening. And oftentimes people buy land without understanding or having an ear to go on to research what is the historical occurrence and significance of an area. And of course, exhibitions on river and flood. In other parts of the world, these areas are areas where archaeological studies are conducted to understand the behavior and patterns of people before. In floodplain management, there's some areas that flood, and we believe that we have to start to use flood alert signs. There are none in the island, but they're standard international signs, and we need to move towards that. Now, of course, plans for rare earth storm events. Since we have climate change predicting, we have in greater intensity, and in depth, we need to have plans that look at those type rare events. And of course, development of the riverside, the example of the Constitution upstream river, the Constitution River, our road, that's an example of riverside spaces in which people can live within the space and enjoy it. And facilities there developed to enjoy it. In emergency activities move on, I think we should look towards flood disaster drills. We conduct them only in-house, and we believe that we have to move towards the community being involved in flood disaster. We've spoken to the fire officer in this context because they also have a role in terms of flood response. And of course, increase volunteer river cleanup or watercourse cleanup and upgrade our depots so that persons can stay at those depots and they have a higher safety level to occupy those during the hurricane season, during the hurricane event. From an institution perspective, then we need to develop a stormwater management app. We have a fire prevention app, but we're not onto prevention, to adaptation and the other aspects within the disaster cycle we need to look at. So the management encompasses not only prevention, but other aspects of the cycle. While there's flood insurance, I think we need to incentivize flood insurance so it becomes an incentive for persons, householders, to purchase and access. And of course, I believe when I say incentivize, I link floodproofing with it. Those persons who live in flood-prone areas, the financial sector can give rebates or discounts to persons who wish flood insurance to those persons who carry out floodproofing of the properties in areas with a potential for flooding. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Charles, for what was really a very interesting presentation, because quite going in sync with our topic, mitigating the effects of climate change. Whereas Tia did let us know that climate change, what's happening, particularly in our Barbados and Caribbean environment, you have aptly reminded us of one of the things that we face quite often is flooding. And how should we go about mitigating the effects of flooding, particularly within Barbados? I found your information was just bang on and really helpful. I want to, ladies and gentlemen, that you can put your questions in Slido, which is embedded to the right of your screen as we go along, so that you don't have to keep that burning question. You can type it in so that you won't forget it. Okay, moving on to the next presenter, and we have Senator Crystal Drakes. Drakes is going to speak now and talking to us really about the financial mitigation efforts. What efforts can be put in place to mitigate the economic and effect of natural disasters on our country? Now, Senator Drakes, as you may know, she is an economist, yes, and she's also not just an economist, but she's also a sustainability strategist and trained foresight practitioner. She works mainly in sustainability products in small island states, and she's an advocate for public policy that is holistic with the aim of ensuring a more equitable future. She's a co-founder of Blue Green Initiative, Inc., a research-driven nonprofit organization committed to promoting a more sustainable future for the Caribbean. As an avid researcher, Senator Drakes has her focus on these particular areas: the integration of foresight analysis into small island state development strategies, the impact of climate change on sustainability, the development goals, 2020 agenda, and alternative ecological economic paradigms for long-term development planning. Senator Drakes has worked with various development agencies and international organizations, such as UN Environment, the IADB, the World Bank, the International Labour Organization, and the Stockholm Environmental Institute. Ladies and gentlemen, our third panelist, Senator Crystal Drakes. Senator?
Thank you so much for the introductions. And I just want to thank the management of the Central Bank for giving me the opportunity to speak this morning. I'm going to share my screen now. So my discussion this morning is going to be around climate change and the economy, and looking at the question of, is a paradigm shift needed? We've heard a lot this morning about the meteorological and the climatic impacts, and we've also gone into some infrastructural implications. So what I want to do is position my presentation in terms of climate change and its real impacts in terms of the economy. Sorry, it seems like I'm having some technical difficulties. So the structure of the impact of climate change, and then I'm going to go into the Caribbean story as it relates to how we have been dealing with climate change here in the region, and then the problems that we face and some of the policy options that we have been instituting to try to mitigate, adapt, and build resilience to climate change. And then I'm going to talk about climate change and the economic system in and of itself. Okay. So the impacts of climate change is both social and economic in nature, and it's also very much all encompassing, and it is pervasive. When we have issues related to climate change, it impacts things like the reallocation of persons living in certain areas, where we're seeing now climate migrants is actually an internationally recognized term, where people have been having to move due to sea level rise in their home areas. There is the impact of shrinking productivity to certain grains and harvests in terms of agricultural production. And that in and of itself will also raise the prices of basic foods that we consume. We also have the issue of extreme meteorological phenomena, which is going to disproportionately affect those in the lower income and below the poverty line. There have been severe droughts in Northern Africa, which have caused a lot of poverty and disallocation of persons in those regions. And we're seeing how climatic events have really and truly shifted the economic circumstance of many persons around the world. Then you also have the issue of diseases spreading due to higher temperatures, vector-borne diseases. More recently, we've been seeing the northern regions becoming a lot warmer, and they have been having issues as it relates to mosquitoes and other vector-borne diseases like dengue, chikungunya, and such like. And that is having an impact on how their healthcare systems have been trying to deal with these new diseases that they have not been accustomed to in the past. Freshwater supply is also another area in which we are seeing an impact on climate change. And people have gone as far, or some experts have gone as far as to say that the next wars will actually be about water. Here in Barbados in particular, we have been experiencing how the lack of water impacts the day-to-day life of everyday individuals. And that also will have economic impacts, because if persons cannot get a consistent supply of fresh water, then it also impacts their level of productivity, if they're able to go to work, if they're able to go to school. And that in and of itself is a real critical area in which we in Barbados, we have been trying to manage as best as possible, but it is an area that we definitely have to look at. And I believe that point was made earlier. And also, when we look at the loss of capacity due to the heat, human beings are actually comfortable within a certain temperature. Once temperatures start to increase, there is going to be an impact on your ability to work in that heat. I know last year during the summer months, we were experiencing some very high temperatures here as well. I know in the UK and across Europe as well, you had these heat waves that were really impacting on the ability for persons to live and to work. And then you have the cost of adapting to coastal areas, which is going to be a significant area for us here in the region, where coastal areas are actually where we live, and that is where we have a lot of our utilities. And that will be an area by which we will feel the impact of rising sea levels, storm surges, and the like. So the impacts of climate change have essentially been costed out through market sectors and non-market sectors. When we look at things like the market sectors, we know there are costs trying to be estimated in terms of what is the loss for agriculture, forestry, fisheries, insurance, public infrastructure, as we've just heard. Our energy sector is another sector that's going to be critical in mitigating and combating climate change or the impacts of climate change, as well as tourism and recreation. And that's even more vital for us here in the region, because we are so heavily dependent on tourism as our economic earner or driver, more or less. And then in non-market sectors that are also being costed into the impacts of climate change are things like human health, the ecosystem, the natural environment, how is the natural environment being impacted, and then fresh water reserves. The economic impacts of climate change by region, when you look at the average real GDP loss by 2050, globally, when we estimate a 4-degree rise in temperature, we are seeing an estimated loss of GDP of 2-5% globally. And then when we look at the breakdown from developing to developed countries, we see that developing countries and underdeveloped countries are again disproportionately affected by climate change. In North America, we have estimates of around 1.1% loss in GDP, Western Europe 1.7%, Asia Pacific region 2.6%. Eastern Europe, 3%. And then you start to get into some of the developing regions. The Middle East is expected to have a 3.7% loss in GDP. Latin America and the Caribbean, 3.8%. And then you have Africa at 4.7%. So we also have this issue of climate change impacting the economy, but also this notion of economic justice. And you have the main contributors of climate change being the ones least impacted. And then you have regions that are not as developed bearing the brunt and the losses that are occurring due to climate impacts.
10 years lower than that of majority white neighborhoods in Manhattan. So maybe it's time we stop celebrating this racist history and start recognizing the centuries of abuse people of color have endured in the name of science.
So we move on now to the Caribbean story, the five seasons.
Priscilla, I may be able to help you. I just have our audience who have the mic on, and we'd like that person to mute it, please. Thank you. Go ahead.
Okay, Priscilla. Okay, thank you. So we move on now to the Caribbean story. The Five Seas, which is the Caribbean Community Climate Change Center, has produced some estimates where they're expecting the cost to the Caribbean to run between 14% of GDP by 2025, which is in another 5 years, increasing there to 39% by 2050 and by 63% by 2100. And they're describing it as an insurmountable challenge to our food security, tourism, and health. When we look at the region, we have about 40 million persons living here in the Caribbean region. And 70% of them, 70% of them live in coastal areas. And that has a significant impact when we look at the rate of which the northern region is heating up. In particular, how the glacier environment is responding to increased greenhouse gas emissions and that impact on sea level rise. Then we have the issue of tourism, as I noted earlier, that we are highly dependent on tourism. I believe we're the most dependent region in the world, some of the statistics have shown, where many of our states, 70% of our GDP comes from tourism related activities. And then you have the issue of commercial agriculture, which also accounts for much of the other activities here in the Caribbean. So we are extremely dependent and vulnerable as it relates to how our economic structure is configured in terms of the impacts of how climate change will affect us here in the region. And when we talk about the Caribbean story, we also have to note that when we look at the Eastern Caribbean, six of the nations in the Eastern Caribbean are ranked actually in the top 10 most at-risk countries by land and population. And then the Caribbean doesn't fall that far behind in relation to our vulnerability to climatic disasters. And it also is pointed out that throughout the 2000s, the Caribbean has experienced average losses equivalent to 1.3% of GDP in damages each year. So year on year, we're seeing this 1.3% of GDP being eroded due to climate impacts. The last statistics that I saw was between 2013 to 2018, the average GDP growth rate was 1.7%. So you see that the loss to GDP is actually being is substantial enough that we can see that any gains that we make on the economic side is actually being eroded by climatic impacts. So just so that we can recap, because we've heard some of this already this morning, the hurricane damage costs in the Caribbean, we had Hurricane Dorian just last year, 2019, with an estimated cost of US $1.5 to $3 billion. We had Irma and Maria in 2017 with an estimated cost of $5.4 billion. What is particularly worrisome for us here in the Caribbean and in Barbados as well, despite not having been directly hit by a major hurricane in a few years, is that the average estimated disaster damage as a ratio of GDP is actually 4.0 times greater for small states than in larger states. And it's actually 6 times higher for countries here in the Caribbean. And we see that very kind of statistic come out very clearly when you look at the impact that Hurricane Maria had in Dominica, where the impact was a cost of 225% of their GDP, and Grenada with Hurricane Ivan, with a cost of over 200% of their GDP. So we face an interesting mix of problems. We have high levels of vulnerability, as we've heard by the two previous presenters, as well as high levels of indebtedness. The average Caribbean debt was 70% of GDP, 70.5% of GDP. We also characterized by low economic growth rates. And we cannot have this conversation in isolation to what is now being called the Great Lockdown, which is crippling tourism activity at the moment. And because we are so dependent on tourism activity, the effects of COVID-19 have really shown us just how vulnerable our economies are. We are also, we have the problem of a reliance on borrowing as well, and relying on external aid and disaster facilities from international financial institutions. As it relates to the policy responses that we've seen to the problems that we've been having, some of the traditional mechanisms have been brought to the table in terms of building in the environmental costs due to the damage that the economy has been placing on the natural environment. So you've had instruments such as carbon taxes being introduced to kind of mitigate or build in the costs of the environmental damage that we've been doing to the environment. Risk sharing tools have also been placed on the table. The parametric insurance, the Caribbean Catastrophe Risk Facility is a very good example of how member states here in the region have tried to pool their risks together in order to develop a tool by which they can trigger financing in the event to assist with recovery costs after a natural disaster. We're now seeing some newer instruments come on board in the form of debt swaps, the debt for nature swap we've been hearing about here in Barbados in terms of swapping some of our international debt to in exchange for putting together a marine managed area or a marine protected area in terms of our coastal and marine environment. And recently there was a announcement by the OECS member countries where they're also looking at a debt for climate adaptation swap. We also have seen investment in climate resilient infrastructural projects like the Richard Haynes Boardwalk here in Barbados that seeks to provide coastal protection, as well as this is also a mitigation measure and an adaptation measure as it relates to things like storm surges. In the event that we are hit by a hurricane, there's that physical infrastructure now on the boardwalk in terms of providing coastal protection for the south coast of Barbados. So I've gone through a few things for the beginning of the presentation, and I'd like to now focus on how does climate change and the economic system go together? What are the systems dynamic that occur? What we have at the moment is an economic system that takes natural resources at an unsustainable rate of depletion and feeds them into linear production systems to produce goods and services. The problem is that at the moment, we do not account for the environmental cost that occurs in the production of those goods and services. And we also do not have a way in which the waste that is produced by that system is converted easily back to its natural state when it was inputted into the system. When we continue now, that linear production system that we've grown accustomed to from the industrial era onwards is actually driven by mass consumption. Consumption is the driver of those linear production systems. And we now have a culture of consumerism. And we have that culture because there's a perception that consuming more in terms of the quantity of things that we consume means that there is some level of prosperity and well-being. That mass consumption or that demand is then obviously taken into account by economists, financial strategists, and we actually use that as an indicator of how well the economy is doing. Through aggregate demand and supply, that then drives the level of unemployment that we have within a sector. But what we have not figured out yet is how do we manage that aggregate demand and supply in a way that is more sustainable? Because the aggregate demand and supply that is happening now, in terms of how we look at the economic system, is then equated to GDP growth. And that is the main indicator at the moment that we have in terms of measuring the health of an economy, despite the environmental degradation and the social inequality that goes along with the capitalist structure of economic systems. And when we look at how we are producing and how we are consuming, that is also driving greenhouse gas emissions. And I want to state here now that the most interesting part of the current economic system that we have is that it is positively reinforcing. When I say it's positively reinforcing, is that the more production happens, the more consumption, the more goods and services people consume, is the higher the GDP growth will be. However, that is not taking into account the inputs into the system, how they're being depleted in terms of the natural resource and the natural capital that we're depleting. And it's also not taking into account the social inequality that happens in the system through the production and consumption structure that we have at the moment. And what the impact of increased greenhouse gases is doing through climate change impacts is it's actually having a negative effect on the system. And that now is exposing the fragility of this unsustainable economic system that we have at the moment. And it is now questioning how sustainable or how do we change the economic system that it is more aligned with the natural environment. So the question then becomes, what is the future of economics? What is the future of economic paradigms and models? Many ecological economists are now being asked how do we fix the current linear system that we have? And I believe that ecological economics now has a greater role in understanding how do we design economic systems to ensure that there is some balance between the economics, the natural environment, and the social component of how we live our lives. And we have to go back to seeing the economic system as a subsystem of the biosphere rather than being a standalone system that just operates on its own, because we're clearly seeing the impact of having that isolated theoretical perspective of the economy can just drive itself without having feedback impacts happening. There is a need now for circular regenerative models of production and consumption and new indicators of prosperity and well-being. And I think where the Caribbean intellectual or economic intellectual thought needs to go is, given all of the peculiarities that we have at the moment in terms of being classified as SIDS, having small open economies, in addition to being very vulnerable to climate change, how are we going to develop an economic model that is satisfactory for us here in the region? Rather than having an international or an outside perspective on economic development. And I focus on economic development because Kate Raworth in her book called Donut Economics, which is where a lot of governments around the world are looking at how do we manage the COVID-19 crisis, because we're seeing that COVID-19 has shown us that any breakdown in the system that we currently have has a direct impact on how people satisfy their needs in terms of, as I said earlier, in terms of how they are employed and how far away they are from poverty. Mm-hmm. And Kate Raworth put together 7 key principles in terms of how do we now move forward with a new economic paradigm for mankind, actually. And the 7 principles are, the first one is the change in GDP as the premier indicator. We have to see if we can find an indicator that is, it is more encompassing and is more sustainable in the things that it measures. We have to start looking at the bigger picture and move away from the neoliberal stance that we've had to the economy, and seeing the economy now dependent on the living world and society. We have to socially adapt as human beings rather than being self-interested. The 4th point she puts forward is embracing a systems thinking approach to the economy rather than a deterministic supply and demand model for economic aggregation. And then also designing systems that better distribute value, because we're also seeing this widening of the haves and the have-nots, the 1% having a much more added value to their worth, and those in the lower and below the poverty level are receiving less and less based on the current system that we have. And then again, she talks about regenerative circular systems rather than linear production systems that we have at the moment. And also a notion that is quite novel, and that is becoming agnostic to growth and focus more on prosperity. And I think that that is an area where the Caribbean region can possibly look at, because outside of the economic justice argument that we need to have economic growth, and that is something that I subscribe to, in terms of we cannot be denied the ability to grow and to provide for our people, to provide jobs and well-being for our people. Is there a space in our economic intellectual thought where, irrespective of growth, there are these things that we have in terms of our development prospects going forward that take into account climate change, and how do we move forward in that direction? So that is an area I think that we should start moving in and having more conversations, given that, and I go back to COVID-19 has really shown us that what we currently have is unsustainable, and it is extremely fragile. What we have to do now is to look at COVID-19 as a test run for climate change. It truly has been a test by which most of the world has failed, really. And the climate impacts are going to be more pervasive and long-term. And if we don't get a grapple on how do we reorient our lives, how do we reorient our economies, so that we live in a just, safe space, both as human beings and both the environment, we could find ourselves in some trouble in the long term. So that is the end of my presentation, and I just want to thank you, and I look forward to any comments from the audience.
Thank you. So your presentation was really so, particularly when you made the point that all our GDP gains can easily be eroded by the impact of climate change. Yes, thank you so very much. I took the liberty of thinking that, ladies and gentlemen, you wouldn't mind joining us if we just extended our time, well, 10 minutes. Yes, make sure. And our last presenter. Now, this presenter for me Oh, before I do that, let me remind persons, because some persons have been saying they want to put their questions on Slido, but they're having challenges. So let me explain to you how to do it. Slido is at the bottom of your screen to the right. You will receive a security verification prompt taking you to an external site. Scroll down and click continue. You can then post your question in the Q&A panel. Yes? So just remember, you'll receive a security verification prompt that takes you to an external site. Scroll down and click continue. And once you do that, you'll be able to type your question in the Q&A panel. I hope this has been helpful. All right, my next presenter here, for me, needs no introduction. And for many of you, I find it will be the same. It's Randy Graham, and he's currently the CEO of Massy United. Randy is a seasoned industry professional. He was formerly the CEO of the Financial Services Commission, and as well as the director of one of our insurance department there. Under his remit was the responsibility to build out the FSC in all our various roles, be it when it comes to insurance, pensions, credit union, and securities, and the securities sector. Ladies and gentlemen, I present Randy Graham. Randy, over to you.
Okay, thanks, Sarlene, and morning to all, and thanks to everyone for taking some time to join us in this discussion this morning. Thanks, of course, to the communications unit of Central Bank and the FSC working as hard as usual. Very creative in this COVID environment to be able to carry on the domestic financial institutions conference, even in this form of media. So big thanks to that team who I know have obviously had to work very hard to put this together. So I've been asked to give a sort of a practical view of the impacts on the financial system from climate. I'm very glad to take it in that approach, because the speakers before me have articulated very well the technical aspects of it, and I will just do my part to be mercifully brief so we can get to the question and answer section. So if I jump straight into it and discuss a hurricane, now I must admit I didn't spend enough time in school in physics or geography to understand much about the hurricane. So I'm glad that the technical folks went before me. But if I could explain it in terms that certainly I can understand. If we contemplate cold water in a pot, you won't get any steam, any convection from the water in a pot. As you turn it on and it starts to heat, we see convection and we see steam rising. The hotter the water gets, the point of boiling, then you get more and more. So global warming is warming our world and warming the waters. As the waters out in the ocean get warmer, you get more convection, more steam. Water cools, the air cools, it falls, and it starts the convection. And because the world is becoming warmer, we are getting these bigger, more powerful hurricanes. And hence, climate change is negatively impacting in the form of the strength and the frequency of the hurricane, because we are warming the globe and we are warming the waters. Now, hurricanes in themselves are natural disasters in themselves, but specifically, a hurricane causes damage in three basic ways, right? So we talk about the wind, which is constant wind pressure from the hurricane pushing against your properties, pushing against your car. And listen, I take no responsibility for anyone getting a ticket, but if you want to get a sense of what 100 miles an hour of wind feels like, if you get your car up to 100 miles an hour and you stick your hand out your window, and you feel the strength of the wind pushing against your hand, you could understand what sort of force we are talking about with those winds. And for that force to be consistently pushing on property, on trees, it snaps, it breaks property, it breaks trees, it removes life, it takes the roof off of buildings. This is what the wind damage to the hurricane brings. We also heard very much about the flooding, and we all know we can't stop water once it starts to get together and move. And flooding is the other part of the damage that comes along with the hurricane, because there's loads of rain during the hurricane. And less talked about, but very much as dangerous, is the storm surge. I'm not talking about tsunamis or tidal waves. Just talking about regular storm surge, that water that we bathe in on Sundays, that coming onto our lands, onto places. If you contemplate where you go to Pebbles Beach and you have a sea bath, now you park on the side of the road. Now we're talking about the water coming in, covering all that section. And that is the storm surge that causes damage. So the hurricane causes damage in those particular ways. Now when we talk about property damage from a hurricane, which is one form, it's not an insignificant sum. So Hurricane Maria would have been 100 million, Irma, another 50 to 100 billion. Ivan, which we are more familiar with, was in excess of $50 billion in damage. So the property damage, the houses, the cars, your fridge, your contents, your TVs, and so on, in terms of being damaged by the hurricane, tens of billions of dollars that a hurricane can cause. In addition to the property damage, we also get disruption. So there's no running water, no access to food, no access to medicine. These things just come to a halt during the hurricane period, and we have a disruption of life. We also get no economic activity. So there's no buying, there's no selling, there's no retail, because everything is damaged and closed and not operational. Our payment systems and so on are broken during the particular period. And then, of course, you get unemployment, because with companies being closed, no one is working, you get unemployment rates increasing, as we've experienced to some extent during the COVID environment. And you get the unemployment after the catastrophe. So the catastrophe itself, or the hurricane itself, actually brings a stop to economic activity. So our economy stalls, it stops, it no longer functions. And that is what we face after, in the hurricane. Now, following the hurricane, we have recovery. So in the recovery, the first thing we want to see is the opening of businesses. We want to see businesses reopening so that people can purchase supplies, they can purchase food, they can purchase water, they can get their medicine. You have to see that reopening of businesses to allow for the recovery. Once the businesses are open, unemployment obviously opens back up, and then you get the rebuild. So you get construction happening, you get repairs happening, and then you get economic activity returning to some level of normalcy. And that's how the recovery would occur. As a matter of fact, after a hurricane, you tend to see a boost in economic activity in particular territories, because you have to repair, you have to rebuild in some instances. People buy food in bulk to stock up. So you do see boosted economic activity after a hurricane because of these particular events. Now that is at the expense of discretionary spending. So we're not buying some of the things that we discretionary buy, like maybe clothes and vacations and so on. Funds are not going in those particular areas, and the propensity to save is obviously impacted because we have to spend to reconstruct and rebuild. So we don't have the ability to continue to save, and those are impacted. But you do see the expansion of the economic activity. So economic activity is not a litmus test for well-being, but it does bring government revenue, it does bring employment, it does bring personal revenue, and it does help us get back to some normalcy of life following a hurricane or a natural catastrophe. And that's what we want to see, the economic activity returning after the hurricane. In order for that economic activity to return, we have to have the funding. When you're talking about, looking for $50 billion, I mean, that itself is hard to even see, far less to find to spend. Homes, individuals, individual companies, looking for hundreds of thousands or even millions of dollars to rebuild your home, to reopen your company. Where do those funds come from? I want to spend just a few minutes on the source of those funds. So there are very few sources that we can access. So we talk about grant funding or government stimulus. Some people might refer to it in that way. Senator Drake's mentioned Barbados' GDP at $10 billion, or government's domestic revenues, $3 billion at best on any given year. When we're talking about damage that could be in excess of $10 billion, $20 billion, if you want to be realistic, Caribbean governments don't have access to the type of funding to give stimulus to our populace. So whatever stimulus might be given, one, is unlikely to be in the form of any significant cash. But two, we have to be real about what is reasonably expected a government can provide to individuals like yourself or myself or companies with cash in hand to rebuild. So you know, that conversation has to continue. But the realness of it is that, you know, many Caribbean governments, including Barbados, run small deficits in our budgets, right? In our revenues and over expenditures. So where exactly would these funds come from? You know, it would be a big ask to ask our Caribbean governments in small developing states to fund stimulus. So, you know, be that as it may, persons can go to personal savings. So you can use your personal savings. Many of us on this call have personal savings. You can use those personal savings, right? Well, to the extent that you have access to it, but if you have a house that is a couple hundred thousand and it's you know, demolished by a hurricane, access to those personal savings, you know, to rebuild in the same way is a challenge. It's difficult, if you want to be honest. I mean, not many people at all will have the access to those type of personal savings to be able to rebuild. And we always talk about, oh, there's liquidity in the banking system. Yeah, okay, we agree. There's liquidity in the banking system, and the FSR does speak to liquidity in the banking system. But personal savings in the banking system is what, maybe about $4 billion. Even if every individual drained all of that to rebuild, we still could not rebuild all of our individual likeliness as we had it before the hurricane. So that obviously is another challenge. There is insurance, and you know, over time, insurance has proven to be a very effective way to respond to hurricanes in terms of getting access to funding after the event with cash in hand to be able to rebuild. But we know that insurance, you know, only, you know, at best on average 30-40% of properties are insured. So there is going to be a shortfall if we don't have adequate insurance to find funding to rebuild. And then of course there's lending. So the thought process of going back to a bank to borrow to rebuild or to reconstruct is possible. But in these times, although I'm sure the banks will make lending available, we still have to look at our own propensity to be able to repay those loans and so on. So those are the sources of funding that we have. But if it cannot be accessed, and if you contemplate that I spoke very briefly about recovery, and the fact that countries can recover after hurricane, and they have. Many U.S. states actually show increased GDP after a catastrophe. And for example, in Hurricane Harvey, I think there was $125 billion in property damage in the U.S. But only about $8 billion was lost in economic activity because the funds came back into the system to rebuild. If we bring it back closer to home and look at Hurricane Maria in Dominica, or even through the Northern Islands, you know, our insurance company itself would have paid another $500 million back into the system. Those funds that go to individuals and companies come from external sources into the Caribbean economies, which help with the rebuild and the growth in the Caribbean economy. So that is a source of expansion. But if we don't have access to the funding, if we can't get appropriate loans, if we can't get appropriate adequate insurance cover, if it is that we cannot access concessionary funding after a catastrophe to be able to rebuild economies, to be able to rebuild the properties, and then what we face is incomplete recovery after the system. Economic activity never returns to the pre catastrophe levels, and in a sense, poverty is expanded. Because our societies, our citizens, our people, our companies cannot restart, cannot rebuild, cannot get back up to those particular levels. Unemployment, and we have seen unemployment in the region spiral even in this COVID. But it returns if economic activity returns. If economic activity doesn't return, then unemployment levels continue at that level. We don't have jobs, and we end up with the poverty line increasing after the catastrophe. So, you know, in wrapping up, it goes to continuously say that we have to contemplate the access to funding following these catastrophes, and there continues to be an increasing argument for small island developing states with small open economies to have access to discretionary funding, lines of credit at preferential rates, increase the exposure to insurance, our continued expansion of financial literacy. So we look at different payment systems like we've been having and different forms of access to funding through the banking system and other ways to get funds back into the system after the event to allow for recovery. Because if we do not allow for the funding to come back in after recovery, we can't stop the damage from the hurricane, but what we can aid is the recovery. But if we don't have the funding access to recovery, we will continue to be in a worse position after the catastrophe. And that is what we as Caribbean people are exposed to in terms of the financial impact of the hurricanes. So, you know, I think given the time constraints that we're under, I would prefer to stop there and allow the audience then to get into any questions that they may have for the speakers that went before me.
Oh, thank you, Randy. You're brilliant. Yes, because we have a number of and the other panelists. I am going to ask you in your responses if you could be as succinct and concise as possible. The first question I have, which has been upvoted, is this one, and it says, from a household perspective, how can we build for resilience to avoid damage in flood event or hurricane? And I think either Charles or Randy could do that one. The question, from a household perspective, how can we build for resilience to avoid damage in flood event or hurricane?
Yes, I'll take that one. I think I can go straight. One of the things you find is that people tend to buy, there are two seasons which we say people buy land. They buy land during dry season or during wet season, hurricane season. People who have land who is prone to flooding tend to take up their for sale signs during the wet season. That's a cultural practice. So when you're buying land, if you talk about the cultural practices and proverbs, higher than buying land, you need to investigate, you need to explore the land, ask questions of people who live in the region, the area, the community, the next door. What is it like? What are the threats you have from the land? What's the potentials and constraints? Then you need to invite professionals from the built environment, architects, engineers, or you come to development institutions. Some planning department, drainage division, and I say, look, I want to buy this portion of land. What is the area like? We may not do a depth study, but we can tell you what our flood observations may be or may not be. We can tell you what are development conditions and the guidelines to follow. And then you start to get development costs. Oftentimes, cheap land that is below the market price, you pay a high development cost to get it developed. So persons buy land in waterlogged or potential flooding, they will have to do some engineering works to get it up to the other value. That engineering works you put in gets it close to where the market value is.
Thank you, Charles. Thank you so very much. You've given us some useful information there. I have another question here, and I want to take this one. And Randy, you may be able to help with this one. The question is, how are insurance companies covering events caused by climate change? Often we hear people argue that coverage did not cover floods.
I would be surprised if that's the case. It depends on the type of policy that you have. So there are various policies available on property coverage. Your typical homeowners, farm perils policy will cover water damage. And if you buy the contents, you will also get damage against the water for those. Businesses that have the cover could also extend to cover business interruption, which will protect them against the loss of revenue if their building is closed because of water damage. So the damage is definitely available in the region. If you have to buy the right policy though, because if you buy a fire only policy, that policy does not cover the water damage. So I'm pretty confident that the insurance policies are available to cover the water damage as well as the wind damage. But as a consumer, you have to be certain that you buy the right policy. And I think that if you do that, you should be okay.
Great, Randy. Since I have you on, there's another you. And the question is, how are businesses and institutions preparing for the next global crisis, which is climate change, in Europe? Are they preparing, and how are they preparing?
I think globally we've done a good job raising the conversation about climate change. Mr. Trump may have other opinions, but I think that the conversation about climate change is in a good space. I've spoken about in many different circles, which is important to get the discussion out there. In terms of the preparation, the more people understand the impact of the climate change in real terms to them, the more I think that people would be prepared. So, I mean, understanding on a macro basis what climate change is, how it impacts, on a macro basis, countries and communities is one thing. But we have to drill down into understanding how it impacts us as households or us as companies. And I think the COVID-19 pandemic was a very real situation, right? So when you're given a shutdown order and you have to close a company, then you have to look at how do I keep my company open while I'm on shutdown? How do I make payments? How do I facilitate receipt of funds from clients? What online payment options are available? What access to information is available? If you couldn't answer these questions, you had to stay closed. Staying closed means unemployment. So I think in the climate change discussion, companies now have to start drilling down into those individual questions as to if the catastrophe keeps me closed, how am I able to reopen? How am I able to continue business? How am I able to facilitate customers? How am I able to keep my staff safe? And that conversation in a very practical term as it relates to putting me in a position where I'm closed is the conversations that businesses now have to have. And I mean, COVID-19 did not bring a lot of good things to the world, but it did put into perspective for individual households and individual companies the micro discussion that we now have to have about climate change and what do we practically do the day after the event. And I think that's where the conversation should and will go next in the form of public education and the FSC, Central Bank, IDB, all the institutions that are very well placed to help us continue that conversation.
Well, great, Randy. Thank you so much. But you're taking one for the team as well, because there's another. What is the GAIB manage the climate change associated risk? What is, yes?
Yeah, no, a good question. I know I'm very sensitive and not speaking on behalf of GAIB because it's its own institution, has its own president and administration. So I can speak generally about insurance. And I think that, as members of the GAIB, what is happening and what continues to happen is a relook of the policy wordings that we're having to make sure that we have the correct cover in there for persons who are buying insurance. The worst thing is to have an event and an individual has damage to their house or to their business to present a claim in the insurance company and then hear that, your policy wording does not cover that. At the point of making that claim, understanding at that point, it's a terrible feeling to hear it after the damage. So the public education that we see going on now by the GAIB to put notices out in the public and by insurance companies to continually educate their customers and to make policy wording, I would say more user friendly or easier to read. Are the actions that I see going on in terms of making this better and actions that now have to be expanded in different forums like this to continue that public education so persons are aware of what needs to be done.
Thank you, Randy. You really ably handled those questions. Ladies and gentlemen, let me apologize to Crystal Driggs and the questions you posed directly for her. She has had to go to the Senate and send you her apologies because she was looking forward to having a discourse with you on the various questions that you asked. Well, I must say, though, that we are almost out of time and it falls on me to wrap up. I do thank so many of you. We had over 100 persons who tuned in today to the Domestic Finance Institutions Conference. Let me assure you, first of all, that this is one in the series and we will have another conference in August. So before I go further, John, gentlemen, expressing our appreciation for the brilliant panel discussion we had. I want to thank you, the audience. I want to thank the conference sponsors, the Central Bank of Barbados and the Financial Services Commission. I want to thank especially the team, the communications team from the Central Bank and the research department, as well as the audio and visual crew. I also want to thank Ms. Thea Brown. Thank you so much, Thea. I want to thank you, Mr. Charles Yearwood, as well as Senator Drakes. And Randy, we do sincerely thank you for taking your time out to be part of our panel in what was a very engaging, informative discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, before you go, let me also invite you next Tuesday, July the 28th, to join the Central Bank as the host second in the series of the Caribbean Economic Forum. The topic this time will be Reviving Caribbean Tourism. This will be on July the 28th at 8 p.m. It will be on CBC, VOB, and the Central Bank's Facebook page or its YouTube channel. The panelists for this session on tourism will be the Honorable Edmund Bartlett, Jamaica's Minister of Tourism, Patricia Alfonso Das, President of the Caribbean Tourism Association, Ms. Sue Springer, Director of Corporate and Economic Relations at the Caribbean Council in the UK, Professor Floyd Landis, the Chair of the University of the West Indies COVID-19 Task Force, Michelle Page, she's the President of the Florida Caribbean Cruise Association, and Jeffrey, who's Chairman of the Barbados Hotel and Tourism Association. He will also weigh in on the discussion. We do thank you today for participating in this conference, Mitigating the Effects of Climate Change, a Financial Sector Perspective. And we do invite you to join us again for our next in the series in August.